So now that we've talked about the sample distribution of the sample mean and the central limit theorem, let's go ahead and use this idea to find some probabilities. Now, here's an example. The scores of 12th grade students of the National Assessment of Education and Progress math test for the year 2000 has a distribution that is reasonably normal with a mean of 300 and a standard deviation of 35. Well, that means that X, I'm going to use X for the variable here, is distributed normal with a mean of 300. If the standard deviation is 35, that means the variance is 35 squared. Now, I don't know what 35 squared is. I could grab a calculator and tell you, but who cares? It doesn't really matter. It's 35 squared. That's the number. Remember, this has the order mu sigma squared, mean variance. So, first of all, let's find the probability that a single randomly chosen student has a score of at least 300. So this is saying, what is the probability that X is at least 300? And we know that this is my distribution. Well, if I draw a picture, is right down the middle. I need at least 300, which is 300 or more. So I need this probability. Well, I'm not going to go to TC Stats and do this because this is the mean. And it's a bell-shaped curve. That means that's 0.50. That's a half. Done deal. I mean, you can verify that in TC Stats if you want. And notice we didn't use anything yet. We did not use anything yet from this chapter. This is actually a previous chapter question. And now I know, oops, this is part B, not A. Now I want to know the probability that's at least 350. Well, the probability statement is I want to know probability X is at least 350. So again, I would draw my curve. Always, always, always draw pictures. So 300 is here someplace, or we're here down the middle. 350 is up here someplace. I am looking for that probability right there. So here in TC Stats, I'll select probability distributions. And just like before, the normal distribution, we said the mean was 300. The standard deviation was 35. The sample size was 1, it's individual. The lower bound was 350, and the upper bound was infinity. So I'm just going to turn infinity on. And then I'm going to calculate, and I get a probability of 0.0766. So just as a quick review, this is saying that a little over 7% of all those tested would have had scores of at least 350. Okay, now suppose we have a randomly chosen group of 26 students. I want to describe the sample distribution, the sample mean, and justify the parameter values. Well, we know that X, the population, is normal with a mean of 300 and a variance of 35 squared. So X bar will be distributed normal with a mean of 300 and a variance of 35 squared divided by 26. Now, something that I want to point out here is this is n. Well, guess what? N is also sitting right here, but it happens to be 1. When we're talking about the population, we're talking about individuals. So n is right there, and it's just 1. That's why we never bother to write it, because anything divided by 1 is just itself. It doesn't have an effect. But when n is not equal to 1, then we absolutely have to write it. We have to put it in because it plays a big part in our calculation. Now, this is not actually based on the CLT because we had a situation where we knew the distribution is already normal. Because the population is normal, we know the sampling mean would be normal. If we did not have this information, n is not quite big enough for the CLT to apply. We'd really need to have at least 30 for the CLT to apply. Now, if that were the case, let's just suppose for a moment that we knew that the mean for X was 300, and we knew that the variance was 35 squared, but we did not know We did not know that the distribution was normal. I'm talking about the parent distribution now. We did not know that. So if we had n of, say, 32 or something like that, then we could say x bar is distributed normal, mean of 300, a variance of 35 squared over 32. That's given to us. And then we could say by the CLT, because n is greater than or equal to 30. In this case, it's actually 32. Now, for my class, this is absolutely paramount. You will not get credit if you don't do that, because this is setting up the assumptions. This is not only saying that n is greater than 30, this is saying you actually looked at it. Remember when we did the binomial, you just don't simply regurgitate the assumptions, you connect them to your scenario. Here, what we would say is because x is distributed normal. That's the justification for saying this. That's the justification for those parameter values. If we didn't know x was distributed normal, we were using this scenario, then we would apply the CLT because the sample size is big enough. Now, continuing on, this is the exact same question we did earlier, but it's saying had an average score of at least 30. So the probability statement is I want to find the probability that x bar is at least, I said 30, I meant 300. So that's exactly what we did up here, only it was just x. It wasn't x bar, because we're talking about individuals. Now I'm talking about the averages. Well, if I draw a picture, the picture is going to look exactly the same as it did before. 300 is right down the middle. I'm looking for probability being at least 300. Well, again, that's a half. There's nothing to do there. That's a half, because this is still the mean. Here I want to find the probability that randomly chosen group of these 26 students had an average score of at least 350. Okay, well, that's the exact same question we just did earlier. Where is it? There it is, 350. Only this was x. Now we're talking about x bar, the averages. So the probability statement will be the probability that x bar is at least 350. Again, I draw a picture, and yes, the picture looked identical to what we did before. And I'm looking for this tail probability. Now remember, when we draw these pictures, this 350 is setting right there just as a graphical representation to help me through the thought process. This tells me my lower bound is 350, my upper bound is up here at positive infinity. And then I'm looking at what's known as the right tail. In reality, if I were to draw this to scale, 350 may be really close to 300, or maybe so far out here it'd be like off the page. That doesn't matter. This is just a representation to help you think about what's going on. So if I go back to TC Stats, this is actually set up, except the sample size is not 1. The sample size is 26. Now calculate, and the probability is incredibly small. 1.617 e negative 13. Now, we've seen this. We've seen this before. This is scientific notation. What this means is I'm going to take this decimal and move it 13 places to the left. Oh my gosh, that is so incredibly small. For all practical purposes, it's about zero. So what we say is that it's approximately 0.0000. Now, that is not the same as zero. What this is saying is I'm going out 4 places, and out 4 places, it's zero. But somewhere to the right, if I were to keep going, somewhere to the right, I'm going to see some numbers, and there they are. If I had 12 zeros, and then I would see, well, let's go ahead, just for the heck of it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 1, 6, 1, 7. So typically we go out, as a rule of thumb, 4 places in this class. This is simply saying out to 4 places it's 0, but way out here someplace, there's something in there. It's just that it's so small we don't really care. for all practical purposes, it is essentially zero. It's not going to happen. So why is it that we had such a drastic change? We went from 7% to almost nothing. And here's the reason. Let's just say that this is my parent distribution. Right here is 300, and right here is 350, and we know this tail has 0.07, I forgot what it was, 0.716 or something, it's roughly 7%, it doesn't really matter at this point. That's what happens when we know that X is distributed, distributed normal, with a mean of 300 and a variance of 35 squared. Now comes along X bar, which is distributed normal, 300, with a variance of 35 squared over, in this case, 26. So what just happened is the variance got really, really small. Compared to 35 squared, it's 35 squared divided by 26. It's 1/26 of what it used to be. So this is not exactly to scale, but the idea would be that this distribution X bar would now look more like this. Very peaked relative to the other. But see, on the empirical rule, if we go out three standard deviations, we have essentially all of our distribution. Well, three standard deviations on this blue curve is going to be here, which should be like probably less than one standard deviation on the black curve. Both of these blue curves and the black curves actually have the same amount of area under the curve. It's one. But because the variability is so much smaller, it's 1/26 of the other, it's not spread out as much, so it's much more peaked. So being way out here at 350 is a long way from the visible end of that tail on the blue curve. But on the black curve, it's not that far away. We could actually figure out the z-score on it, which we should do. That'd be kind of fun. So z is going to be 350 minus 300 divided by the standard deviation, which is 35. That equals 50 over 35, which is in the neighborhood of approximately 1.4286-ish, less than 1.5 standard deviations away. But for the blue curve, it's going to be a little bit different. Z is going to be equal to 350 minus 300 divided by the square root of 35 squared over 26. Remember, the standard deviation is the square root of the variance. So that's 35 squared over 26, which is 50 divided by 35 over 26, which, based on some basic rules of algebra, is 50, I'm thinking ahead of myself here a little bit, 50 over 35, so that's the same as this, multiplied by 26, square root. I missed my square root down here. Just supposed to have a square root on it. Sorry about that. Square root of 26 over 1. Well, square root of 26 is a little bit bigger than 5. So this is going to be a little bit more than 5 times this z-score, which is actually roughly 7.2843. So this is a little bit less than 1.5 standard deviations away, this 350 in the black curve. That same 350 is well over 7 standard deviations away from the mean in the blue curve. So how likely is it that we would have an average of 26 people way up here? Not at all likely. Keep in mind, for this to happen, what we would need, let me draw another curve here just for a second. Here's 300. Here's 350. For an average to be near 350, I'd have to have a bunch of samples taken near 350. Picture this as a number line, and these are values that I picked. I would have to have a sample up here. Otherwise, the average isn't going to be up here. If I had somebody way down here in my sample, which I might, I need more up here to counterbalance that to give me an average of 350. Well, that is a possible sample. That could have happened, but it's very, very, very unlikely. More likely, you're going to get samples near the distribution, or near the mean. Or if it's not near the mean, if it's representative of the population, it may be all spread out, but it's spread out probably more denser in the middle, but it's spread out on both sides, so the average, this X bar, would be closer to 300. It'd be very unlikely to get a sample way up here. Seeing the major density of the curve is near the mean, that's where we'd expect any sample that is reasonably representative of the population to live, somewhere near the mean. Hence, getting an average way out here at 350 is just not all that likely.